If you've got your Bibles there, please go ahead and open them up to James chapter 4. James chapter 4, and we'll head into our next section, section 3, and we're going to start with this. What causes fights among you? What causes fights among you, and where can we see this this descent into depression in the Bible? And there's a lot of different places that we can see it. But let's have a look at one place. And this is James chapter 4. And so I'm going to read it to you. We can start here. James chapter 4, verse 1. James says this: what causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? What a great question. What a great question. How many people do we have married here today? Okay, great. Okay, so this is a great question to ask whenever there is conflict in your marriage. What is causing quarrels? What is causing fights? We always have the answer. It's right here, all right? What causes quarrels? What causes fights among you? Is it not this? Your passions are at war within you. And so let's have a look up on the screen. First of all, we begin with anger, okay? So what causes quarrels? What causes fights among you? Anger is described as quarrels. It's described as fights. What causes quarrels? What causes fights? Is it not this? Your passions. That's lust. Your passions are at war within you. And lust is described as passions. Verse 2 says, you desire, that's lust, you desire, and you don't have, so you murder. You get angry. You covet. That's worship talk. That's talking about idolatry. You covet and cannot obtain, and so you fight and quarrel. So clear that anger flows out of lust. There's passions and desires and covetousness. There's idolatry. I can't get what I want, and so I get angry. Now look at this. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. Our lust infects our prayer life. And look at verse 4. You adulterous people. Why is he calling them adulterous people? Here's why. Because lusting after something and seeking satisfaction in something other than God is spiritual adultery. It's spiritual adultery. We are united to Christ. We are one spirit with him. And when we turn away from God and we go seek to be satisfied in something else, it is spiritual adultery. And it goes on, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? And so look at all the ways that lust is described. Passions, desire, covetousness, which is idolatry, spiritual adultery, and this friendship with the world. Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is to no purpose that the scripture says he yearns jealously over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? When we set our affections on things of this world, God is jealous for our affections. He's jealous for our affections. But look at this, verse 6. But he gives more grace. Praise the Lord. There's grace for these anger and lust issues. There's grace. Where's the grace? Notice this. Therefore, it said, God opposes the proud. Why does he say God opposes the proud? Here's why. Because from pride flows our lusts and our anger. It's from pride. God opposes the proud. And then it says, but gives grace to the humble. So what is the answer for pride? Well, we're given two answers here. There's grace for the humble. So we want to be in a place of grace. So we need to humble ourselves. Verse 7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God. So what is the answer for our pride? We need to humble ourselves. We need to submit ourselves to God. But then there is even a greater solution. Look at this. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Resist the devil. How do we go about resisting the devil? Well, Ephesians 6:16 says that we need to hold up the shield of faith, the shield of faith that extinguishes all the flaming darts of the evil one. So we need a truth-saturated perspective. We hold up the shield of faith, and the flaming darts, the lies of the evil one, are extinguished. So faith. We resist the devil by holding up the shield of faith. 1 Peter 5:9 says to resist the devil firm in your faith. Faith. We resist the devil by standing firm in our faith, by holding up the shield of faith. Next, he says, draw near to God. How do we draw near to God? Well, Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God, because whoever would draw near to God must believe he exists and rewards those who seek him. And so ultimately, what is the solution to this anger, lust, pride thing? It's faith. It's faith. It's believing. It's having a grid, a perspective that is saturated in the truth. It is setting the Lord always before us, because the ultimate problem is ultimately this, unbelief. Unbelief. Where does it say that? Well, let's continue reading. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you, what does it say? Double-minded. Double-minded, that is unbelief. How do we know it's unbelief? Well, turn back to James chapter 1 and have a look at verse 5. James chapter 1, verse 5. It says this, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Unbelief is the ultimate problem. And we can see this connection from unbelief to pride, to lust, to anger, all right there in James chapter 4. Love that so much. So let's have a look now at how we can use this descent into a depression chart in our lives to fight unbelief. And to do this, repent. To repent of unbelief. Because we can kind of think of it like this. Imagine for me this dam. There's a dam that is holding back all of this water. And right at the base of the dam is a village. And one day there's a crack in the dam. And water starts to spray out. And then water is pouring down into the village and flooding the place out. And so the council kind of gets together and they say, we've got a water problem. What are we going to do about the water problem? And so they discuss it, and here's what they decide. They decide that they're going to go about 10 kilometers away from the city into the fields with some mops, and they're going to start to clean up the water about 10 kilometers away. Because that's a really bad plan, because it's dealing with the symptoms. It's not actually getting to the source of the problem. They have to go and repair the dam. Likewise, we need to focus in on the biggest problem, not all of the problems that flow from it, but the biggest problem, and is the problem of unbelief. The problem of unbelief. So we need to learn how to work our way down from unbelief. So if we have a slide of that staircase of the heart, let's have a look at that. All right. So unbelief. I don't have my eyes on the Lord, leading to pride. I have my eyes on me, leading to all kinds of lusts. I have my eyes on the things of the world and fears, leading to all kinds of spiraling problems, okay? We need to be able to work our way down this chart. So for example, if we know we are struggling with an anger problem, you know, I get angry at my spouse, I get angry at my kids, I get angry at work, I get angry when things aren't going my way. We need to be able to work our way down and say, okay, well, this is my problem. Why do I have this anger problem? Well, here's why. Because I don't have my eyes on the Lord. I primarily have my eyes on me. I'm lusting after the things of this world and seeking satisfaction in them. And then I get angry when I don't get what I want. And here's why this is important. Because if we have an anger problem and we just focus on anger and we read all the verses about anger and we make our whole thing about anger, we're not actually going to get anywhere. Likewise, if we have a fear problem, we just focus on the fear, we're not going to get anywhere. If we have a lust problem, we just focus on lust, we're not going to get anywhere. If we have a pride problem and all we focus on is pride, we're not going to get anywhere. We have to get to the source of the problem, which is I don't have my eyes on the Lord. All right? And then we can begin to move into the next section, which is faith, getting our eyes on the Lord, which is the ultimate solution, okay? Setting the Lord always before us. So we need to be able to work our way down this chart. But working our way down this chart is insight. It helps me to understand how I've arrived at where I am. Why am I struggling with this thing? It helps me to have a degree of insight. But insight is not transformation. Insight is not transformation. And insight is not repentance. And this is really important. Insight is not repentance. Just because we understand something doesn't mean that we are now being transformed. So what does repentance look like? Repentance looks like this. Let's say we're struggling with anger. Repentance looks like this. I come to the sudden realization that I'm angry. And forgive me, Lord, for this anger. I'm angry right now. Why am I angry? I'm angry because I want something and I can't have it. Lord, forgive me for my lust. Forgive me for my idolatry. Forgive me for my spiritual adultery. Lord, and the reason I'm lusting after this is because I'm so focused on me. Lord, forgive me for my pride. And the reason I'm so focused on me is because I'm not focused on you. Forgive me for my unbelief. Lord, who are you? Show me. And that's where we begin to move into the really exciting part, which is faith, okay? Which is faith. And so maybe you are here today and you find yourself lusting after the idol of the approval of man, all right? Like so many of us. And when you don't get the approval of man, you find yourself maybe in a place of self-pity. Maybe you find yourself in a place of anger. Maybe you find yourself in even a place of depression. So what does repentance look like? Repentance looks like this. Lord, I am lusting again after the praise of man. Please forgive me. And Lord, I'm lusting after the praise of man because I'm so focused on me. Lord, forgive me for my pride. And I'm so focused on me because I am not focused on you. Forgive me for my unbelief. And this is an entirely different thing than just confessing our anger. We need to get deeper. We need to get into the heart. Maybe you're here today and you're worshiping the idol of control. And you just want to be able to control. And when you can't control a situation, you get fearful or you get angry. So what does repentance look like for you? It looks like confessing that Lord, I'm lusting after this control. I'm going to this broken cistern. I'm committing spiritual adultery. I'm seeking satisfaction in control. God, forgive me. And the reason I'm doing that is because I'm so focused on me. Forgive me for my pride. And I'm so focused on me because I'm not focused on you as I need to be. Forgive me for my unbelief. Or maybe you're here today and you're lusting after the idol of comfort. The comforts of the world, the pleasures of the world. What does it look like for you to repent? It looks like confessing your lust before the Lord, your idolatry, your spiritual adultery, and understanding that the reason I'm lusting after these things is because I'm so focused on me. God, forgive me for my pride. And the reason I'm so focused on me is because I'm not focused on you as I ought to be. Forgive me for my unbelief. That's what repentance looks like. And we grow in repentance. We aren't born repenters. We have to grow in this, all right? And then we get to move into the, like I said, the really exciting stuff because we don't just repent. It's repentance and faith. And that's what we'll be spending our time speaking about next time. But let's do this. Let's do this. I'm going to pray. And then if we can break back out into our groups for about 5 or 10 minutes and discuss these two things. What does insight look like for you? What does it look like for you to be able to go down the chart, But then what does repentance look like for you? What does repentance look like in terms of being able to go up the chart and confessing sin to the Lord? All right, so let's focus on those two things as well as any other insight that the Lord has given you tonight. All right, so let's pray. Let's pray. So Father, we understand that you hate sin. We understand that our sin is a barrier in our relationship with you. God, we want to grow in our adoration of you, God. And so often we turn our back and we head off in search of something else that we believe will satisfy. God, forgive us. Forgive us. Help us to take this seriously. Help us to see our sin as what it is. There's spiritual adultery happening in our lives. God, there's idolatry happening in our lives. Help us, God, to hate this and to turn and to embrace you and to truly believe with all our hearts that you alone can satisfy the deep spiritual hunger and thirst that we have. So God, would you please lead us now during this time? And God, we thank you that you are with us. In Jesus' name, amen.